Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Feeding Washington's Army, Surviving the Valley Forge Winter of 1778 by Ricardo A. Herrera. Narrated by Adam Verner. Publisher's note, this audiobook may refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. This project began while I was a historian on the Staff Ride Team, U.S. Army Combat Studies Institute. I was building a staff ride on the Philadelphia campaign of 1777 to 1778, and writing the stands, the locations where participants discuss a particular action, decision, or piece of terrain, for the Valley Forge portion. Staff rides use battlefields and larger areas of operations as classrooms and primary documents over which students, traditionally military, walk, talk, analyze, and discuss decision-making, leadership, and their applicability to the modern military force. Among other things, staff rides are predicated upon the movements, maneuvers, and actions of military forces. The period between the Army's marching into Valley Forge in December 1777 and marching out in June 1778, however, is largely static. The ride needed movement, if only for an hour in a longer day spent at the park. Activity, not immobility, is at the heart of the endeavor. Thus, the challenge of examining Valley Forge, an encampment. While pausing at Anthony Wayne's statue, I drew from Wayne Bodle's first-rate study of the encampment, The Valley Forge Winter, Civilians and Soldiers in War. Wayne gave attention to the Army's patrolling and foraging activities as soldiers and civilians interacted during the winter of 1777 to 78. The answer to my problem was to reframe Valley Forge as an 18th-century predecessor to the modern forward operating base, FOB, a fixed, albeit temporary, defensible position from which military forces operate. From FOB Valley Forge, the Continental Army maintained a security line to the east and south and sent patrols into the countryside to contest the space between the encampment and British-occupied Philadelphia. Soldiers from FOB Valley Forge marched out to forage in search of food and supplies for the Army. All this was much more than passively and miserably sitting in freezing huts and starving. Here was action. Here was the movement to sustain something of the staff ride's conceptual momentum. The focus of the stand at Anthony Wayne's statue would be the Continental Army's actions to feed itself, its sustainment operations, in current parlance. The story behind the Army's efforts to sustain itself in February of 1778 is much larger and more important than the actual act. The bigger story is one of a maturing general, George Washington, and his officers and soldiers. The Continental Army, if one argues for a line of continuity that traces to its birth on 14 June 1775, was but 32 months old in February 1778. In that period, the Army had lost more fights than it had won. The main army under Washington had won signal victories at Trenton and Princeton, but its record of wins to losses was anything but respectable. Yet Washington and the Army had persevered, learned, and matured. By February 1778, Washington was able to give subordinate officers like Nathaniel Greene, Anthony Wayne, Henry Lee, and others broad orders that gave them the latitude needed for the exercise of their initiative. This book's genesis lies in my teaching at the U.S. Army School of Advanced Military Studies, SAMS, and in my previous position on the Staff Ride Team. Scholarship informs my teaching, much as teaching informs my scholarship. The two are inseparable. Out of the need to introduce movement, 1 hour of teaching at Valley Forge came an article. A second and third article, several conference papers, and a blog post later emerged. This book is the ultimate expression of that teaching moment. In small things, greater ones often in here. Introduction. The Army must soon dissolve. Following months of active campaigning, in December 1777, General George Washington led the Continental Army into winter quarters at Valley Forge, a place whose name in American history is synonymous with privation, suffering, and endurance. From the late spring of 1777 through the onset of that year's winter, the Army had marched and maneuvered well over 200 miles from its encampments at Morristown, New Jersey, to Cooch's Bridge, Delaware, to Chadd's Ford, Pennsylvania, and beyond. Eventually, the Army's journey led to Valley Forge. It had marched to fight, and fight it did. Washington's Continentals and local militias had clashed with General Sir William Howe's British regulars and Hessian auxiliaries at Cooch's Bridge, Brandywine, Bowley, Germantown, White Marsh, and other places over the course of the Philadelphia campaign. The Continentals and militiamen had lost more battles than they had won, and yet the Continental Army had held together. As the end of the normal campaigning season, late spring through autumn, neared and then closed, General Washington convened several councils of war with the Army's other generals to determine whether the Army should wage a winter campaign or enter quarters until the spring. In the end, Washington determined that his soldiers would winter at Valley Forge. It was the least bad option within a limited range of possibilities. Washington's decision to order the Army into a winter cantonment at Valley Forge came about only after a lengthy series of considerations with the generals, congressional delegates, and local politicians. In the end, the approaching winter, the Army's physical circumstances, and political and strategic necessity joined forces to limit Washington's courses of action. Ever the risk-taker, Washington was also ever the realist. The Army that wintered at Valley Forge was near enough to Philadelphia to challenge British occupiers for control of southeastern Pennsylvania, but doing so exacerbated the Continental Commissariat's near inability to feed its soldiers. Washington's undertaking, buttressing Pennsylvania's government, exercising the writ of the Continental Congress, and denying the British exercise of political power, however, precluded his making any other decision. Faced with this complex and challenging strategic and political environment, Washington and the Army made the best of a poor situation, constrained as they were by the strategic calculus of war. December 1777 was bad enough for the Army, but worse was yet to come. Faced with the collapse of the Commissariat and the all-too-real potential of scattering the Army across eastern Pennsylvania so that it might feed itself, Washington was on the horns of a dilemma. Without food, the Army would be compelled to abandon Valley Forge and surrender all hope of challenging the British for control of southeastern Pennsylvania. Choosing the more difficult path, maintaining the Army's position at Valley Forge, Washington set in motion the Continental Army's riskiest and most complex operation it executed while there, the Grand Forage of February 1778. Washington had nothing but poor prospects before him. The Army had to maintain its position in the Great Valley. Faced with this, Washington acted decisively so that his soldiers might survive, so that the Army might take the field in the spring and continue the war for American independence. The Grand Forage of 1778 was an act of desperation and a demonstration of Washington's willingness to accept risk while meeting a crisis. By February, the Army was on the verge of dispersal or dissolution. Its logistical system had collapsed. Without food, soldiers faced starvation. Without food, Valley Forge could not be held. Confronted by a stark range of choices, Washington acted and launched a grand forage to gather up as much livestock, forage, flour, and other needed goods to feed the Army. The expedition involved some 1,500 to 2,000 soldiers of the Continental Army, a substantial portion of the roughly 6,500 able-bodied, armed, and uniformed Continentals at Valley Forge. It included elements of the Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, and New Jersey militias, and contingents of the Continental and Pennsylvania navies. The forage spanned southeastern Pennsylvania, southern New Jersey, northern and central Delaware, and northeastern Maryland. It lasted nearly 6 weeks and engaged an estimated 2,300 British soldiers, about 1/6 of the able-bodied British force in Philadelphia, as well as several vessels and crews of the Royal Navy. The Grand Forage of 1778 is largely unexamined. Historians and biographers of the major actors have treated it narrowly or failed to grasp the full picture. Generally, works that do treat the American encampment and the British occupation of Philadelphia have given the Forage only the most casual attention. The uneven coverage of the Forage is due to two central factors. First, compared to the campaigns and battles that bookended it, the Grand Forage was small indeed. In terms of raw numbers, the 3,800 or so Continentals, Britons, Pennsylvanians, Delawareans, Marylands, and New Jerseyans who took part quite simply paled in comparison to the several thousand soldiers who had fought at Brandywine and Germantown before the encampment, or would fight at Monmouth afterwards. Yet, while the Forage was smaller than the Philadelphia campaign or the Battle of Monmouth, a closer study reveals in fine detail some of the operational, logistical, and civil-military complexities, constraints, and opportunities commanders in the War for Independence faced. An examination of this foraging expedition reveals a side of warfare that the larger battles of the War for Independence cannot: the vital efforts at sustaining the soldiers who fought. Hence, a closer study of the combatants' military and logistical operations reveals the great extent to which they devoted their time and energy at feeding themselves, and how they accomplished those tasks. By considering operational and logistical efforts together, a better and more nuanced picture of the Army's capabilities emerges. Indeed, in the February foraging, the Continental Army demonstrated its tactical and operational maturity and acumen, as well as its improvisational skills. The Continental Army was an active force that challenged the British whenever and wherever possible, but only on Washington's terms, when he could help it. Washington planned carefully and accepted risk as he balanced it against opportunity. Moreover, the Virginian trusted his commanders to execute his broad concept of the operation. He gave them the latitude to interpret his orders expansively and to deviate from them when necessary, trusting, however, that they would hew to his broader intentions. The Army's activity that winter is a startling contrast to popularly held images of the Army and the encampment. Herein lies the second reason for the Grand Forage's obscurity: the power of myth as popular history. For most Americans, including military officers, the Valley Forge cantonment is little more than a national morality play highlighting the virtuous self-sacrifice and patriotism of George Washington and his ragged band of Continentals. Sketched in broad outlines, they marched along frozen, snow-choked roads, leaving their bloody footprints to mark their route of march in the cruel Pennsylvania winter. While these patriots, ignored by Congress, their parent state, and local farmers, starved and froze, they endured in the service of the glorious cause, independence. By way of contrast, General Sir William Howe and the British Army enjoyed the winter and the pleasures of Loyalist society as they gambled, dined, drank, and whored while snug and warm in occupied Philadelphia, the erstwhile American capital. Many recall the appearance of Baron Friedrich Wilhelm de Steuben, formerly a Prussian officer, who single-handedly and with vulgar charm transformed the Continental Army from a group of individualistic and undisciplined Republican warriors into citizen soldiers, part of a well-drilled machine able to stand up to British bayonets. In the mythic telling, the Continental Army emerges as a static force, a Greek chorus trumpeting stoic martial values and patriotism. While there are kernels of truth to these legends, they reduce the Continental Army to passive witness and caricature. Instead, this book contends that the Continental Army at Valley Forge was a field army engaged in active operations. The myths ignore the Continentals' nearly constant combat and reconnaissance patrols, and the foraging the army undertook to supply itself, and to deny those supplies to the British. In the scope, planning, and execution of the Grand Forage, Washington revealed his burgeoning acumen as a planner and commander, and his long-standing willingness to accept risk. Equally important, the Grand Forage revealed the maturity of the Army's leadership and some of the logistical staff. The operation was too distant and too dispersed for Washington to exercise direct control. Thus, he relied on the experience and judgment of his generals, dozens of field and company-grade officers, the Army's logistical staff, the Navy's, and militias. Washington exercised central command, but placed his confidence in his subordinates. Meanwhile, his opponent, General Sir William Howe, demonstrated a singular lack of interest in the largest and riskiest operation undertaken by the Continental Army in the winter of 1778. His belated response to the opportunity presented by the Forage was halting and hesitant at best. Valley Forge lay exposed, yet he did not seize the moment. When Howe did act, his subordinate commanders entrusted with the mission showed little of the aggressive spirit that had been a hallmark in the previous campaign. As for the Continental Army, its distress was due to several factors, most of them beyond its control. Chief among them were the ever-tottering commissariat and quartermaster general. In its quest to protect liberty against power and avarice, Congress had purposely limited the authority of the commissary general and the quartermaster general and their purchasing and distributing agents. Constraints on power and greed may have protected liberty, but they also impeded the Army staff's ability to feed, clothe, and supply the Army. Without logisticians, the Army could not fight. Moreover, worthless continental currency, the weather, the roads, and, of course, the British Army, also conspired to bring the Continental Army to its knees. By January 1778, the Army's commissary and quartermaster departments had collapsed. Major General Nathaniel Greene noted bitterly, "The troops are worn out with fatigue, badly fed, and almost naked." The soldiers, some thousands of the Army, had been without shoes for months past. It is difficult to get sufficient supplies to clothe the Army at large. "The naked soldiers," wrote Greene, "have been upon the eve of starving, and the Army of mutinying. Lack of food and poor hygiene, resulting from the want of acids and soap, left soldiers getting sickly in their huts. As for the Army's horses, they were dying from by dozens every day for want of forage. Both and man and beast suffered." Writing from the Army's camp on Schuylkill, Brigadier General George Whedon observed the region and reckoned it a plentiful but distressed country. The British Army had marched through the area in the closing days of 1777 and had subjected it to ravagements that were shocking to behold. Nonetheless, Whedon continued, "Debilitated as our troops are from the exceeding hard service during their whole campaign, their zeal for the country does not abate, and though they suffer greatly for want of shoes and other necessities, they seem determined to surmount all difficulties and turn hardships into diversion." But gilding the rhetorical lily and diversion did not fill bellies, clothe backs, or keep feet shod. Colonel Timothy Pickering, a member of the Board of War and Washington's former adjutant general, was very sensibly pained over the Army's distress. "The lack of food and clothing," he feared, "may not be of short duration. Meat, whether fresh or salted, seemed unobtainable. Indeed, he doubted where an ample and constant supply of flesh can be obtained." Perhaps, wondered Pickering, the Army might reduce the meat rations and increase the bread allowance to compensate for the reduction. After thinking about this possibility, Pickering dismissed it, for he supposed it scarcely possible to diminish the ration of meat and increase that of bread, for the Army had as little flour as it had flesh. Difficulty upon difficulty had plagued the commissariat for months, even before the cantonment. William Buchanan, Commissary General for Purchases for the Continental Army, complained about his inability to purchase beef, pork, or whiskey at the prices fixed by the Board of War. Even when local representatives fixed prices, they proved too low. Writing to President Thomas Wharton of Pennsylvania, Buchanan thought the rate established by Pennsylvania's Council of Safety for the purchase of wheat sufficiently liberal, yet he found that it failed to satisfy many avaricious people. The farmers, wrote Buchanan, refuse to sell or thresh for sale any of that article unless purchasing agents meet their exorbitant demands. If farmers refused to sell, then Buchanan's deputies and their assistants would be forced to impress wheat and flour. For, as Buchanan informed Wharton, the army must inevitably want bread very soon. This, however, did not hearten Buchanan. He found impressment extremely disagreeable, and asked Wharton and his counselors for their advice and assistance in developing some other method than force. Try as Buchanan and his deputies might, their efforts were often in vain. As much as Buchanan deplored farmers' avariciousness, he did not want to forcibly seize foodstuffs or any other private property. Congress, on the other hand, its fear of power notwithstanding, had put aside ideological purity and fears of military tyranny in favor of practicality. It was willing to take a risk and trust that its own army would uphold its commitment to civilian control and respect for private property. It was not an easy decision. As early as 6 October 1777, Congress had authorized the commissaries general to impress and seize wagons, shallops, and proper storehouses. It granted this authority until January 1778. The following month, delegates granted Buchanan the power to purchase or impress wheat in the sheaf. It also directed Buchanan to apply to Pennsylvania's government for assistance. Authorized or not, Americans considered the impressment of private property an abuse of power, little better than legalized theft. As was so often the case during the American Revolution, people looked back on history for repeated abuses of power by imperial authorities. Their own government seemed to be following British practices. To most people, impressment was little more than the military usurpation of civil authority, liberty under attack by all grasping power. Buchanan understood this as he tried to walk the fine line between military necessity on the one hand and personal liberty and property rights on the other. It was to no avail. Even the soldiers themselves questioned the commissaries' motives. No matter how sincere their commitment to revolutionary ideals, their respect for liberties and rights, or their energy in doing their duty, soldiers and civilians alike damned the commissaries left and right. Samuel Tenney, surgeon of the 2nd Rhode Island Continentals, was at his wit's end. He, along with the rest of the army, had been without food for several days. "I am still alive and not altogether unmindful of absent friends," he wrote. "However, when you are informed that we have been 5 days without provision, the former will appear a little strange." Tenney poured his scorn upon the commissariat, particularly Thomas Jones, Deputy Commissionary General for Issues. Jones was responsible for distributing the provisions that Buchanan's staff had purchased. Surgeon Tenney believed that there was a set of men about the army endeavoring to ruin it with D. Commie General of Issues at their heads. Jones, Tenney noted, is detected in his villainies, and we all hope he will suffer with thieves, spies, and moneymakers in this world, and with hypocrites and unbelievers in the next. Whether Tenney was wholly serious or merely venting his rage is difficult to tell. Nonetheless, his fury was sincere and shared by more than a few soldiers. Tenney's villain Jones was not the sole culprit. Instead, the commissariat was plagued by financial problems that were much more complex and invidious than Tenney could imagine. Americans had financed their war for independence through paper Continental dollars. As early as June 1775, Congress had authorized printing $2 million, which had increased to $6 million within another 6 months. Before the end of 1776, $25 million in Continental scrip circulated. Backed solely by faith and hope in the United States, both of which sank with British victories, the value of Continental money plummeted. By 1778, the exchange rate of paper to specie was 5-1, and it only got worse throughout the course of the war. It was not until 1777 that Congress made any effort to animate the states in levying taxes. Without the power to impose taxes, all Congress could do was importune the states to tax, take Continental dollars out of circulation, and raise their value through the resulting scarcity. However, faced with the need to arm and equip their militias, the states printed their own money and virtually ignored Congress's requests. As for foreign loans, they were minuscule until about 1780. So Congress and the states printed ever more money. By 1777, the commissary and quartermaster's departments had expended $9,272,524. The following year, that rose to $37,202,421. At no time during the war did Congress or states ever establish any semblance of order over their finances. That would have to wait until sometime in the future. In the meantime, the value of American dollars fell in proportion to their numbers in circulation. Much as the value of American fiat currency fell, so too did the strength of the Continental Army. The main army's returns, a tabulation of bellies to fill, were as variable as the weather. The army's assigned strength fluctuated between a low of 14,892 soldiers, excluding militia, when it marched into the cantonment area in December 1777, and a high of 22,309 when its last units departed in June 1778. The number of soldiers actually fit for duty, however, tells a different story. That number never exceeded 13,751, which was registered in June 1778. Fully one-third of the main army was combat ineffective at the height of its strength while at Valley Forge. At the time of the Grand Forage, the number of soldiers fit for duty in February and March 1778 was 6,264 and 5,642, respectively. The number suitably clothed, armed, equipped, and ready for active campaigning was considerably less. The great disparity in numbers was due to a host of factors, including soldiers falling ill, dying, or deserting. In other cases, units performed duties away from camp, and recruiters failed to drum up recruits. Other complex factors affected the army's sustenance and the soldiers' condition. Bad weather and worse roads compounded the dismal logistical picture. An outbreak of atrocious weather in the first week of February continued throughout the month. On 5 February, the Schuylkill River, which divided the Army's main encampment on the right bank from its local magazine on the left, was impassable because of flooding. On 6 February, Colonel Israel Angel, commanding the 2nd Rhode Island Continentals, noted, "This morning was very raw and cold, and rained as hard as ever I saw it. The next morning, the snow was about ankle deep." In nearby Lancaster, diarist Christopher Marshall noted that the roads are near impassable. "The situation of the camp is such that in all human probability, the army must soon dissolve," wrote Brigadier General James Mitchell Varnum on 12 February. Historian Wayne Bodle has suggested that the army was fast approaching collapse, and probably would not have lasted through March 1778 unless it could obtain more food. The problem was not that Pennsylvania was barren. It was not. There were supplies to be had in the counties of Bucks, Chester, Northampton, Philadelphia, Lancaster, and York, and in the states to north, south, east, and west. But transporting them to the army was difficult. The roads were poor, and even under clement conditions, the journey was difficult for heavily laden wagons. Colonel Ephraim Blaine, Deputy Commissary General for Purchases for the Middle Department, noted the neglect within the quartermaster's department for not keeping up a continual supply of wagons from the magazines with provisions. Blaine had not received one brigade of wagons from Lancaster or the back counties this 3 weeks, due in part because the quartermasters had no power to press wagons or drivers into service and have great difficulty in procuring a single team of horses. Sadly, he noted, the army will suffer. Increased military traffic, to the extent that this was possible, merely churned up the roadbeds, which in the freeze, thaw, and rain cycle made an already arduous journey hellish. Furthermore, wagoneers often siphoned off brine from barrels of salted fish or meat in order to lighten their loads, thus spoiling the food. Many simply jettisoned barrels along the roadside, while others cut short their daily mileage, began their journeys late, frequented taverns along the route, or failed to prepare forage and fodder for their animals, resulting in a late start the next morning. A tottering commissariat, reluctant farmers and manufacturers, dishonest, inept, and lazy contractors, near worthless currency, inadequate transport, inclement weather, dreadful roads, and more, made maintaining the cantonment a difficult proposition. Meanwhile, the British Army competed for food and forage, and conducted raids and patrols throughout the countryside, which compounded the Continental Army's problems. To the southeast of Valley Forge, the British Army wintered in Philadelphia. If considerably more comfortable than were the Continentals wintering in their huts at Valley Forge, the British found that feeding themselves was no easy task. As redcoats patrolled the countryside around the city, British commissary agents escorted by large formations did their best to provision the army from local farms. Howe took care to safeguard his foragers and what they gleaned from the countryside. On 26 January 1778, Howe's Hessian aide-de-camp, Captain Friedrich von Munchausen, noted the dispatch of 3 regiments this morning to cover our foragers and wagons, all of which returned unmolested. They brought almost 200 tons of hay into Philadelphia. Often enough, however, lone farmers and millers brought their goods into British lines. Sir William's foragers particularly favored the lands east of the Schuylkill, where loyalism was more pronounced, the enemy's presence was lightest, and there was less risk of being caught on the wrong side of a rising river. Colonel Walter Stewart, whose 13th Pennsylvania Continentals foraged through northeast Philadelphia County and Bucks County, estimated that enough flour and other provisions to feed from 8,000 to 10,000 men goes daily to Philadelphia, carried in by single persons, wagons, horses, and etc. But while a large quantity of Bucks County's bounty entered British lines, something that astounded Washington, British agents discovered that providing for the Army and Navy was still difficult. In southeastern Pennsylvania, specie and escorts to city markets might encourage many farmers, but fresh provisions were still difficult to obtain. Every family farm had different subsistence needs, and their political loyalties were as varied as their numbers. The region was anything but pacified. British foragers had swept through Valley Forge and the surrounding area before the Continentals occupied it in December 1777. After the onset of winter, life between the lines became increasingly dangerous for soldiers and civilians alike, as the two armies competed for popular affections, political power, and subsistence. The region easily contained 100,000 civilians, who also needed to eat. Marauding bands of furloughed Continentals, deserters from both sides, bandits and Continental militia and British patrols, looked for easy pickings of all sorts. Continental pickets summarily executed farmers bringing produce and livestock to Philadelphia. Major John Graves Simcoe, commanding the Loyalist Queen's American Rangers, wrote that, "To prevent this intercourse, the enemy added, to the severe exertions of their civil powers, their militia, to enforce the Continental Congress's will, although the number were by no means sufficient for stopping the intercourse between the country and city." The conquest for control over the lands between Valley Forge and Philadelphia led observers to bemoan the effects of the struggle. Brigadier General Jedediah Huntington thought, "We are watching a country that has little to reward us." He hoped, however, "It is for the best that we are stationed here at Valley Forge, though I must say I do not see it." He believed that the British were in such desperate straits that they had forsaken any hope of regaining the affections of the people or of their cheerful submission to the Crown's authority. Indeed, as Huntington observed, their burning the country as they have done is an evidence they despair not only of conquering, but of holding it in subjugation, save by the sword. Timothy Pickering's assessment was, if anything, even sharper than Huntington's. He pronounced Chester County the most disaffected in Pennsylvania, and went on to damn the people as barbarous wretches. He took bitter satisfaction seeing their distress, now that their kind protector, the British, have plundered them without mercy or distinction. In this contest for the people's loyalty and support, Pickering aptly noted that these barbarities will doubtful have their natural effect, to excite the resentment and alienate the affections of these people. Pickering's vengeful side was such, however, that he was pleased to see how one old Dutchman and his sons had been cruelly plundered. He took grim satisfaction when one of the sons watched his opportunity and killed two British soldiers, wounded two, and took one of the plunderers, and the old man who before had his rifle said he would go home, put his rifle in order, and get revenge. Physical destruction merely exacerbated political and armed conflict, which in turn contributed to further destruction. Armies that sought to gain allies among the people instead alienated them and created enemies. The war was as much a contest for people's affections and their support as it was a contest of arms. Destruction wrought for the sake of vengeance was satisfying, but its immediate consequences and the long-term effects militated against any sort of succor, settlement, or reconciliation. Emotion had the whip hand. The struggle over Pennsylvania's lands and peoples hindered both armies' ability to feed themselves. The inability of Sir William's agents to sustain the army locally forced British commissaries to transport large quantities of food from New Jersey, Delaware, England, and Ireland. But the greatest reliance, especially for livestock, was placed on large detachments of soldiers who roamed both sides of the Delaware. Fuel could be had in the local area, but forage and fodder for horses and cattle had to be supplemented by hay shipments from other areas, particularly Rhode Island. As for the Continental Army, its situation was so desperate that Washington ordered commanders responsible for the magazines that were to supply the army for the upcoming spring campaign emptied and brought to Valley Forge. The garrisons protecting the magazines were forced to fend for themselves. The Continental Army's dire circumstances might have reduced it to the passive, suffering host of legend. They did not. Indeed, the Army's straitened condition impelled it into action, and it prepared to undertake its largest operation while at Valley Forge. Recent intelligence indicated that the British were preparing to mount a large foraging expedition sometime in mid to late February, at a location unknown to Washington. On 12 February, Washington ordered Greene to scour the countryside between the Delaware and Schuylkill Rivers and Brandywine Creek for livestock and send all of it to the army. The task was of the utmost consequence, hence Washington's reliance on his ablest general. Greene would therefore prevent the enemy from receiving any benefit, from the sheep, cattle, swine, and horses even, as he eased the present emergencies of the American army. Washington's concept of the operation was twofold: feed and supply the Continental Army, and deny the very same foodstuffs and materials to British. This was not a combat mission, thus it was imperative that Greene take measures for preserving his force. While contemporary estimates of the size of the force that Washington placed under Greene's command ranged from 1,200 to 2,000 soldiers, the roughly 1,400 stated in the order Colonel Angel recorded provides a likely total for the number that marched out of Valley Forge. Washington instructed Greene to give farmers certificates in lieu of cash. In addition to foraging, Greene and Wayne were to destroy all the provender on the islands between Philadelphia and Chester, which may be difficult of access, or too hazardous to attempt carrying off. The expedition effectively collapsed the Continental Army's eastern screen and uncovered those approaches to Valley Forge, as it sent forth so much of Washington's combat power to gather food and supplies. Already overstretched by its mission and low effective strength, the army was unable to support the militia or mount sizable patrols east of the Schuylkill while the grand forage took place. Washington's only forward security was now the understrength Pennsylvania militia, which, despite active service in the preceding year, was better suited for home defense than as a proper adjunct to the army. Washington pleaded with the president of Pennsylvania, Thomas Wharton, Jr., to call out and strengthen the militia in order to secure the countryside east of the Schuylkill. This was not a new matter. Washington had urged Pennsylvania's government to turn out the militia in strength during the invasion summer of 1777. He continued his repeated urgings until the army marched out of Valley Forge in June 1778. The state's government had done its best by issuing repeated appeals to the men, but as it and Washington well knew, turning out the militia in these trying circumstances was only slightly less difficult than feeding his soldiers. Wharton and the county lieutenants faced the insurmountable task of mustering enough militiamen to do their duty. They had faced this problem from the outset of the British invasion, and it continued to dog them throughout the occupation. Indeed, Pennsylvania's struggle to muster its militia in adequate strength was representative of a larger problem faced by every state throughout the war, that of raising, equipping, and fielding adequate numbers of militiamen, not to mention raising recruits for the Continental Line. The problem was never solved. Just over a month before the Grand Forage commenced, Pennsylvania's government ordered out two classes of militia from the County of York, two from the County of Cumberland, two from the County of Northampton, and one from the County of Northumberland. It directed the county lieutenants of Philadelphia and Bucks to supply 20 light horsemen, each without officers, as they must be necessarily divided into small parties, where officers will be useless. The militia was to screen between the Schuylkill and Delaware rivers, while mounted patrols should be kept on the several roads for intelligence and other purposes. As an added inducement, the state promised to recompense the mounted troopers for losses or damages to their horses, arms, and accoutrements. Naturally, the gentlemen who turn out as light horsemen will be excused from serving when called in their classes. In spite of these incentives, county lieutenants reported grave difficulties in getting the militia to answer the call to duty. Colonel Richard McAllister of York wrote that his county's militia seems determined not to march. Pay was the issue. The call of duty and satisfaction derived from virtue and selfless service only compensated a man so far. Men who had been called out before made great complaints respecting their pay, which they say they have not received. Were the state to settle the matter of pay, or the counties able or willing to collect taxes for that purpose, McAllister believed they would go something freer. Under the circumstances, however, it was almost impossible to get a constable to do his duty in respect of the militia, or any other person, to undertake the collecting the money. They will rather go to prison. McAllister noted the appeals that were held in sundry places for the 6th and 7th classes of militia, and that the next week there were several companies ordered to march. A conscientious man, Colonel McAllister was out in different parts to hurry them out, but the coldness of the weather and the grumbling about the pay is in every mouth. The lack of pay affected all of the militia. Colonel William Coates, Philadelphia County's lieutenant, was busily employed in holding appeals and collecting substitute monies from those not inclined to serve, but well off enough to pay for a substitute. The county paymaster reported to Coates that pay was in arrears to tune of £2,000, enough to pay off several of the classes of militia. Brigadier General John Lacey, Jr. of the Pennsylvania Militia also noticed the poor turnout. Lacey commanded the state's forces covering the eastern approaches to Valley Forge and was responsible for denying forage and subsistence to the enemy. Lacey's numbers were so low that we cannot by no means act together, either by patrols or in case of alarm, by which means some of the roads leading to my camp are left unguarded and open to surprise from the enemy. He recommended removing his headquarters some 3 or 4 miles away from the enemy in order to prevent such an occurrence. Despite Washington's remonstration that his present position is at too great a distance from the city and puts it in the power of the disaffected, very easily to elude your guards and carry on their injurious commerce at pleasure, Lacey did his best and regularly shifted his bases and patrol routes, but the militia's poor turnout prevented Lacey from doing much. The militiamen who had earlier reported numbered around 300 and were due to return home by 1 February. And as for the light horse ordered from Philida and Bucks County, not one of them yet appear. Lacey learned from the county's lieutenants that they have not received any orders to raise or send any. As January turned to February, Lacey was forced to consolidate his men into one body, as it is impossible to do any service in the weak and scattered condition. The militiamen spent 2/3 of their time hunting for provisions, because they were too far removed from the reach of the commissaries. By 11 February, Lacey's 300 were now reduced to between 60 and 100. Reduced numbers were bad enough. They were compounded by an accident in which 6 to 7,000 cartridges were taken fire and blew up. The explosion burned 5 men and set fire to nearby tents, which destroyed a number of blankets and cartridge boxes in them, the numbers not exactly known. The day following the orders to Green and Wayne to mount the Grand Forage, Washington reassured Lacey that he had pressed President Wharton on the weak state of the militia, and had let him know that unless the number of men, 1,000, which General John Armstrong promised should be kept up, are regularly and constantly in the field, it will be impossible to cover the country on the other side of Schuylkill. Wharton's, Lacey's, Washington's, and the county's lieutenant's efforts were almost all for naught. With only 60 men fit for duty, Lacey was compelled to report, "My force is at last reduced to almost a cipher." The problematic nature of the eastern approaches was not solely the province of Pennsylvania's militia. The inability of the Continental Army's cavalry to secure a strong outpost at Trenton compounded the militia's insufficient defense of the eastern approaches. For both political and logistical reasons, Washington had dispersed the bulk of the 4 regiments of Continental Light Dragoons throughout New Jersey, in small detachments rarely larger than a troop. As conceived, the cavalry at Trenton was to have stiffened and supported the militia that was to have cut off Philadelphia to the north and northeast. Reality, however, confounded the plan. Brigadier General Casimir Pulaski, chief of the Army's cavalry, arrived at Trenton with elements of the 1st Continental Light Dragoons on 8 January, 1778. Expecting to find 3 days' forage for his horses, Pulaski discovered that there was none to be had, nor had provisions been made for its delivery. On top of this, sailors of the Pennsylvania State Navy were quartered in the town. Having scuttled their galleys after Fort Mifflin's fall in November 1777, the galley men claimed prior possession, think they are entitled to hold it, and refuse to budge. The lack of quarters and food for the light dragoons merely exacerbated the situation, which caused Pulaski to appeal to the civil magistrates for assistance in establishing a magazine, and Washington for ordering out the sailors. If nothing suitable could be done, Pulaski suggested shifting his forces northward, about 25 miles to Flemington. In the meantime, Pulaski divided his troopers into squads and further dispersed them. While this eased the pressure on the limited quarters and food, it dissipated Pulaski's and thus Washington's mounted force and its combat power. Washington was not about to order out the sailors. If the only objection to Trenton be a little difficulty, that may at first occur in procuring the most desirable quarters for the officers and men. He assured Pulaski that the barracks and town would provide ample quarters for both. Room was found, but the issue of forage plagued Pulaski throughout the winter. Ironically, what forage Pulaski obtained was ferried over the river to Trenton from Bucks County. For the horses' sake, quartering in Pennsylvania would have made more sense, but Congress had resolved that New Jersey demands, in a peculiar degree, the protection of the armies of the United States. Washington faced a dilemma. He had to both protect New Jersey and sustain his cavalry, and Congress had limited his options. Hence the demands of civil authority competed with and overrode military necessity, and forced Washington to attempt squaring the civil-military circle. Circumstances forced Washington to rely on Pennsylvania forage and fodder shipped to New Jersey. Extending protection to New Jersey meant that patrolling north of Philadelphia was out of the question. ferrying horses and troopers across the river, exposed New Jersey to the enemy, and the light dragoons to the force of the Delaware River's current and ice flows in winter, and to the Royal Navy. It was no wonder that Howe's foragers made their way undisturbed in the northern liberties and beyond. By relying on the Pennsylvania militia, Washington was making the best of a poor bargain. The army buttressed Pennsylvania's weak government and denied the British free rein in southeastern Pennsylvania. Yet in doing so, Washington and his Continentals walked the fine line between the exercise of power and the practice and defense of liberty. Had the army intervened more forcefully in civil affairs, it might very well have upset the delicate relation between the army and state government. Still, the chief problem was the lack of Continental soldiers. Shifting Continentals into the void east of the Schuylkill would certainly have stiffened the militia, but would also have undercut the state's already weak image and hold on the region. More importantly, however, it would have expanded the Army's area of operational responsibility, and the Army simply could not afford to take on more. The 13th Pennsylvania Continentals, the 1st Continental Light Dragoons, and others had foraged in the region and patrolled it before the foraging expeditions, and with no perceptible effect against the enemy or in strengthening Pennsylvania's already uncertain authority. Washington realized that the militia's strength, presence, and ability were, at best, contemptible in British eyes, and that General Lacey was unable to patrol his area adequately. The best Washington could do was plead, cajole, and exhort the state's government and its militia. So weak was the Pennsylvania militia that British patrols daily marched or rode out of Philadelphia, 4 to 5 miles, all the while ignoring the militia. Under these trying circumstances, Washington's decision to launch a grand forage revealed the limited range of options available to him and the consequent risks of his decisions. Washington, therefore, set in motion his greatest gamble while at Valley Forge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.